This tech gave credit card yourself exclusive specificity beyond what's present in the RKO version. The
thing says that you can use
and studying their functions, we and others have identified six roles of cryptocurrency right there. To summarize them, the first role of ACT is finding irreversibly the ubiquitated currencies. Then the ACT agents are able to unfold the substrates, because only unfolded polypeptide can be translocated to a small opening in the alpha rings, which you have to permeate to enter the central degradation chain. In fact, this is a gate entry place, and one of the roles of ACP, which we now understand, is to open this gate, which allows translocation into the disrupted central chain. We now have an almost atomic understanding of this gate opening process, and let me just share with you some of my favorite electron micrographs. Through the work of several postdocs, but especially David Smith, we're able to show that ACP binding leads to an opening that is the entry site of substrates. The S-ray diffraction by Lowell and Huber had shown that the 20 S eukaryotic chromosome is actually closed at each end. But then, in collaboration with the Pimina, they were able to hypothesize a gating function to define removes these N termini of the alpha subunits. Substrates could enter and be degraded. These substrates are exactly one. This is a very low activity one, which substrates can only enter when it's tested until at the end of the moment. But when ACP or a non-hybridizable agent with neurons binds to the larger bond, the gate opens and substrates can enter. When ACP is hybridized to ADP, the gate is closed. And in the intracellular environment where potassium is high, the proteasome is maintained in an inactive environment, even at a free 20S bond gate closing. Now, the mystery of how we get it open was advanced when David Smith noticed that in the Arteo ACP agents, all six identical subunits have a hydrophobic tyrosine S motif, and a similar C-terminal motif is found in three of the ACP in our eukaryotic proteasomes. And we were able to show that the binding of the ACP agents involves the interaction of this motif with openings on the top of the proteasome alpha rim. In fact, this was documented by mutagenesis, by destructive enzymes, or most beautifully, by taking C-terminal peptides and adding them to the 20S proteasome, as we and also G. Martino's lab were able to do. This step, we now know, allows the C-terminal peptides to bind to these pockets found between the alpha rings. This is the S-ray diffraction image from 10 years earlier that we really didn't understand, and it became clear from our work and Bill's work that these pockets have a critical glycine residue that the ACP agent's hippo smoky interacts with because they open. A talented IOEM expert, Yifan Cheng, collaborated with David Smith to obtain the following images of the RKO proteasome. In green is the S-ray diffraction from the work 10 years earlier. The cryo electron microscopic density coming from 20,000 different images is shown here in yellow. The red on the where the peptides bind, if they contain a different smoky, the different smoky is the royal back. The peptides do not bind in a specific locus in the alpha ring openings. This is enough to open the subunits, allowing other peptides to come in and bind to the central beta ring where the substrates bind in the alpha ring. We now know much more about this structure, and from another electron micrograph, looking down at the 20S proteasome, we can see an image as shown in the right here. The cryo electron micrograph densities show the amino termini of each alpha subunit, and they cross in the middle in proteasome site. Steroids and such are eukaryotes, making an area of substrate skin permeate. Interestingly, the earlier X-ray diffraction can resolve the structures that the cryo electron microscopy shows. Then when the peptides are added, as occurs with ACP binding of ATP, we'll see the gate open, gate closing, gate open. I love these images because they are near atomic resolution.
Traditional databases are mostly open, they're mostly secure.
blockchain, which is stable, and listen to a minister, to one entity, and therefore they can that database, they can delete loads, they can even censor data from getting in the process. And this creates a lot of challenges when you're interacting with different companies that are competitors, and don't trust each other to report that data. Disagree any of the mistakes or even malicious activities over what the state of the actual truth is, and that results in a lengthy legal action disputes, which are expensive. In addition to that, if there's a photo, he has a copy, I have a copy, that's fine, but if there's any money or Tesla stock, he needs to know that I no longer have that, or I have already sent that to someone else. So we need to make sure that assets are transferred for anything of value, or it doesn't make any sense. So the traditional solution to this is a centralized entity, such as PayPal, your trust to record who runs what, and not move that around, but even that's quite inefficient when such services and other industries, people don't necessarily trust that small mistakes can lead to millions of dollars of errors. And so that problem gets even worse when you're dealing with multiple different centralized entities for different assets across different geographies over the world, maybe within these networks. It's quite time-consuming, moving between them is very difficult, and then fix something as a better way. Yeah, so the answer is blockchain, right? So essentially, blockchain, as Dan said, is a shared distributed ledger. Everybody has a copy, the same copy of the database. It's trusted, right, because it's secure, right? And we can have this in another different configuration. We can have a permissioned distributed ledger that is a sort of closed system in general, and you know, so that's not the point. But the important thing is, everybody has the same copy of the ledger. There's a single source of truth that we're working on, whether it's Dan himself, or trading, or it's a third-party regulator that's checking out what we're doing. So we've done some existing blockchains such as Bitcoin, Ethereum, Ripple, and Bitcoin is specifically designed to create a censorship-resistant digital cash. Ethereum to create a distributed autonomous organization application platform. Ripple vision is sort of extend trust between each other and bypass banks. But none of these are really designed with the needs of enterprise and regulated financial institutions in mind. A lot of the design decisions that went behind Bitcoin are needed to create Bitcoin's application. It's one application, it's not generalized across many applications. As a result, there's limited throughput, 3.4 to 7 transactions per second, slow confirmations, 10-minute blocks, so you need to wait for about 60 minutes to have a high degree of confidence that's gone through. Lack of privacy, most of these platforms are completely open, but just anonymous, anonymous processes. So you don't know who is storing the data, which location they're in, and so it ends up as a concentration of mining in China. So even theoretically, businesses find it hard to trust that China can come out and attack the network tomorrow. The setup from core governance generally is disorganized. There are challenges that come to light within Bitcoin, particularly recently, and particularly with no settlement finality, which is something that our clients really care about. It's probabilistic that transactions won't be reversed. We need to know that when a transaction's through, it's done, it's stuff that can't be reversed. So hence, this is a new potential revolutionary technology that's very exciting. It requires multiple specialist skills from consensus algorithms, encryption, cryptography generally, security, and stability, and scalability. No one startup or a large company can develop entirely themselves. It's used by multiple parties. It's decentralized by its nature, and so it's controlled and monetized by no single entity. And because of that, a strong governance model is vital to its health and to its development. And so that's why we initiated the project development foundation and built up the governance project. I think that's exactly right. And so, last year, with the chair, my God, and a few others, and three of our closest friends, and we went to launch the Ledger project, which essentially is called the Ledger Project. We hope to be able to create a content industry about the standard for blockchain, and that we can let them know that this is a transfer of industry into how it uses and does business. So we have, as I mentioned, three of our closest friends, and we started out with Jim, did a miraculous job, I think. I think it was like a shield of water at the wrong company. It was high levels of light, you know. And so we went to Jim and said, hey, Jim, we can do something.